Yeah, I know what she means when she says we're going to stay on time. That means I'm going to be short. No, thank you, Irene. That's very, very kind. Want to start off by recognizing some people that are very special and who really this dinner is in honor of. And those are the members of our Founders Club. You can recognize these folks by, they have a little blue tag on the bottom of their name tag. And these are people who have made a real sacrificial pledge and support for the foundation. They've given $1,000 or more a year to our work. And I'd like to just ask you, if you're part of our Founders Club, would you mind standing for just a moment for us? Yeah, join me in thanking them. Also, like Irene said, we have quite a few folks here as well that are part of our Legacy Society. They have made a decision to make the Freedom Foundation part of their estate, and also a lot of folks who have put us in their monthly giving. And I want to just thank all of you as well. You're definitely very important to the sustainability of the organization. I want to also honor a special group as well, another special group, and that's our trustees. Our chairman of the board, Hans Stoker, is somewhere. Where are you, Hans? There you are, Hans. And we have other trustees. Could you, if you're a trustee, would you mind standing just for a moment so we can recognize you as well? The members of these groups, the ones we just recognized, are very special people to me because they really represent the heart of the foundation. They sustain our work. They give me and all of our staff wise counsel, and that's something I need a lot these days. They help us keep our vision clear. So I want to personally thank every one of you for what you have done to help keep the foundation strong. It's not a small thing to transition from the founders of an organization to a new chapter. And the only reason why we are successful so far in doing that is because of your support for us and your guidance and your advice. Now, Irene helped name this Crossroads, America at a Crossroads, and that's really because I think the thing that we all share here is a concern, right, for our state and for our country. And it really does have a feeling that right now is a crossroads that we are approaching. Now, there are a lot of wonderful groups across the country that are working very hard to try to make sure that this is a crossroads and that we pick the right path in this crossroads. That we pick a new direction for America, that we return to the values that made this country and this state great, the principles that our forefathers put forward. And the Freedom Foundation really, we're proud to be one of those groups. We're proud to have the privilege of working every day to preserve our freedom, your freedom, in this state. In order to do that, the challenge that this organization has taken on from day one, I think, I wasn't there, but I talked to Mary Jo, who was, and she says this is the case. From day one, we knew that we had to reach the hearts and minds of individuals, sometimes one-on-one, sometimes in small groups, but we had to connect with people and persuade them that freedom really matters, that it's important. And in some cases, persuade them what it is. A lot of people in my generation don't have a very good concept of what freedom actually even is. So sometimes persuade what it is, and then persuade why it matters to the point that people will take action to protect it. Now, that's not something that's easy to do, right? For us at the Freedom Foundation, we can't do it just by sitting in our offices and writing papers and sending them out and hoping someone reads them and does something with them. We have to actually take those ideas out into the trenches. We have to actually connect with people face-to-face and help them see how these policies, these ideas, these laws, these legislation, how they actually impact their lives on a daily basis. And I think that that's the thing that really has always set the Freedom Foundation apart, is the willingness to do that. And if you look at our staff, and there's many of our staff scattered among the tables this evening, they are all people that embody that. They're people that are willing to do the hard work of getting out there. Often I walk around the office during the day, and there's dark offices everywhere. And for a moment I think, gosh, where are all these people? They're supposed to be working. And then I look at the board where people are at, and I see, oh, they're at a meeting there, they're training people there, they're off doing the work of freedom. And so I... you know, certainly I'm very proud of them, and I think all of you that are supporters of the foundation, I just want to tell you how incredibly proud you should be of these people that you are supporting, who have dedicated their lives. They're geniuses, they're creative. Usually all I have to do is just help them point in one direction and then let them go and try to keep up. And I could go on all night telling you about the impacts they're having. This has been an incredible last 6 months to see the traction that this organization is getting and the people within it. I won't go on all night. Irene won't let me. So let me just tell you about a couple of things that are really exciting that have happened recently. One of them, let me start off with a question. What do the Seattle Times, the Seattle Weekly, the Olympian, the Spokesman Review, and the ACLU all have in common? If you said they're all organizations on the decline, you're probably right. But that wasn't what I was thinking. Those are all organizations that in the last month have actually supported something the Freedom Foundation is doing. And it's so rare, I have to acknowledge it. Really thanks to the work of Mike Wrights, who's back at the table there, our general counsel, and his team. We're in front of the state Supreme Court. Just 2 weeks ago, they accepted our case against Governor Gregoire. And I think the Seattle Weekly, and I'm going to quote them because I assume most of you don't read the Seattle Weekly. I thought their title said it best. Here's what their article started off. They said, executive privilege case tests the governor's vague claim of right to secrecy. Now think about that, a governor claiming a right to secrecy from the people she serves. That's what this case is really about. This is a governor who has come up with somehow out of the blue, it's not in the statutes, not in the Constitution, this idea that she can shield documents from us, the people, in perpetuity. And to make it worse, the lower court, when we took this decision before them, or this question, they said that not only is that true, but if the governor claims this privilege, then the burden shifts to you, the citizen, to prove that it's wrong. So without knowing what's in the document, without knowing why they decide to do it, all you get is this little piece of paper, and we've gotten these, blacked out, and there's a claim of executive privilege, and you get to try to prove that they're wrong. That's not transparency. That's not open government. And this is a question that we've tried for years, and this has been a lot of hard work on Mike's part and many other organizations working with us to try to get this in front of a court to actually get this question set. This is something that most states have not dealt with in their courts, but that many groups like ours are battling with. So this case will mean something not only for this state. It'll mean that if we win, that the citizens can actually hold their governor accountable, but it'll mean something for many other states as well. Now, few of our battles end up before the Supreme Court. This is not the first, but not too often. Most of them are waged in much less glamorous settings. But we have to go where the people are, right? So we've always been an organization characterized by action, characterized by grassroots. But about 12 months ago, we took it to a little bit of a new level. We tried something, a local campaign. We called it Stop Thurston County, and it was really built around this idea that a county had decided to protect a supposedly endangered species of gopher by basically shutting down the ability of anyone who owns prairie land, which is 55,000 people in the county, of doing anything with their land if they happen to have gophers. Because gophers are endangered, of course. Everyone knows that, right? It was a big experiment for us, and the whole point of it was not necessarily to solve this problem, although we wanted to, but to make a demonstration project. Because as we looked around this state and as we worked with Tea Party groups and citizen groups and all these folks that had really just gotten engaged with what was going on in Washington and the fear and the concern over the overspending, they wanted to change something, but it was hard for a lot of these folks as we talked to them to know what to do to change. You know, we're a long way from Washington, D.C., right? And when you're trying to change the federal government, that can seem like an overwhelming task. And so we wanted to show people how much difference they could make at a local level, that they could start there and they could see victories, and they could see how their little group of 10 or 15 or 50 people could actually change something. And in that, they could gain the hope and the inspiration to be able to take it to the next level. So it was definitely an experiment for us. We're 12 months out from starting that. And today, that ordinance is still in place in Thurston County. You still, if you have prairie, you still can't build on it, or you have to protect the gophers in doing so. But we have turned that county upside down in running that campaign. If you talk to anybody in Thurston County, probably one out of two people, if you said, hey, have you heard about the gopher thing? They'd say, yeah, what's the deal with that? It was top 10 story in Thurston County in last year. It's the impact that we've had, I think, is best shown by something that happened just last month. We wrote about this a little bit. You may have seen this. The county comes up with crazy ideas all the time. They kind of swipe them from counties in California, we found out. They're just pulling them out of California. And one of them was they're gonna ban all duck hunting, in essence, along the shores of Thurston County. And it was really a nonsensical thing. Instead of right now people stand on the shore and they shoot out over the water to hunt ducks, they were going to make them go out in boats 300 yards out into the water and shoot back toward the houses. And that was to protect people. That was the point of it. Well, we found about this. They worked on this for 2 years. It's a real serious deal. They were gung-ho about this. We got a call from these gun clubs who were really concerned, these hunting clubs, and they said, hey, this is over. This is going to go through. I mean, the commissioners in Thurston County, one of them was a past president or director of FutureWise. One of them is a avowed socialist. I mean, these are people, they're not gonna bend over. We just need, could you tell us where to find a good attorney? That was the question they asked us. Just help us find a lawyer. We said, well, just wait a minute. You know, we've been working in this county for a year, and we think we've figured out some things that you can do, and it's not over yet. It hasn't passed. Why don't we just try it? Let us come train you, and we'll see what we can figure out. So they put together two training groups, and we walked them through what we had done, and they walked out of those meetings really excited, but still, you know, they really think this is going to work. Over a period of the next 4 weeks, those groups, they were amazing. They sent in 1,800 unique emails and letters to the commissioners. They came, there was a work session on this. And a work session, if you've ever been to one, these are not public hearings, right? This is just commissioners in a work session. People don't come to work sessions. 200 people came to a work session. They couldn't even speak, right? They just came to be there. And a week after that, the commissioners declared on county public television that this was over. They weren't going to pass this ordinance. That the people had won, and they weren't going to do it. We thought the best part of that was the commissioner saying that her job wasn't fun anymore. But Thurston County, again, was just a demonstration. Right now, we've taken this. Groups have invited us to come in San Juan County. San Juan County is probably worse than Thurston County, if it's possible. But there, again, conversation turned upside down. There are people coming out of the woodwork concerned about all these regulations on land. The planning director just quit 2 weeks ago because he couldn't handle it anymore. There is commissioners' races are actually in play. And now we're getting calls from all over the state because people think if you can make change in Thurston County and San Juan County, you got something you're doing right there. We want to know what that is. So we were just up in Ferndale 3 days ago training a group up in Whatcom County. We're going to be in King County with a group tomorrow night. All over the state, people are saying, we want to make a difference. We're here to change our state. Could you help us come figure out how to do that? So that's something that it's been fun to watch that happen and see the difference being made in little places. But that's a brush fire, right? You start enough brush fires, and we're going to change the state. Now, all of that this year comes together into a one sole purpose. That's our short-term purpose, which is, this election is a crossroads, right? We want as many voters as possible to understand the real question that's being answered by this election this fall. It's not really about policies. It's not really about numbers, or it shouldn't be. We want people to see this election, this is what we're working on in doing all of these things, to see this election as really answering the question of who's in charge. Right? Is it us? Is it we the people who set up this government? Is it the government trying to protect our liberties? Are we the ones in charge? Or are we just here to serve government and help provide the money for their programs? That's the question we want to frame for people. And in everything we're doing, we're trying to have as many folks understand that when they go to the polls this fall. But of course, this is not a one election fight, right? This is something we have to look beyond just one election. That's just an opportunity. Even if Kirby's best scenario happens, it's still just an opportunity, right? It won't happen automatically. We have to then seize the opportunity and do something with it. And the next election has to build on this one, and the next one after that. We have to have more and more freedom champions. And so at the Freedom Foundation, part of our vision is not just short-term, let's change voters' minds. It's let's invest in the leaders of tomorrow. Let's build the people that will be the legislators and the county council members and the school board members or the business leaders tomorrow and invest in them now and help them think about these things and help them understand the principles of freedom. So the other thing that's been new for us in the past 18 months or so is really an expanded work on college campuses to invest in student leaders, to help them have a voice for the free market, to not have to hide when they talk about it, when they're on college campuses. So I had some of our guys just prepare a very short video to show you a little bit of what we're doing in that area and to give you a glimpse of the impact. So Greg, would you take that away? For better or for worse, my generation and the one that follows now hold the future of America in their hands. If we want freedom to endure, we must engage young leaders and teach them about the principles that make our country great.
If you really do care about freedom, you should look at my generation. My generation has no idea what freedom is.
I hope that my generation will realize that the world doesn't work in such an ideal level as they think it does.
Not only are we trying to engage them through things like social media, video, but we are also empowering them to be part of the solution. And that's really why we started our Young Leaders Internship Program about a decade ago. And it's why last year we formally launched our Student Freedom Project, an on-campus internship program. We know that if we can raise up strong leaders who believe in the principles of free markets and limited government, we can change the direction of this country.
I've been unsure of the proper way to address a lot of the concerns I have.
You know, liberty is important, and we need to be free if we're going to achieve anything good.
You know, when we're fighting for freedom, we're all fighting as a team.
I think that we have a very, very strong fighting chance of rolling back big government, which has more and more overtaken our lives in ways that people don't even think about.
Our young leaders do more than just get coffee and file papers. They do work that actually creates change in our state.
Not only am I meeting people and learning about the Freedom Foundation, but I'm actually really learning things about the area of economics, which is what I'm interested in.
California Republicans, a few weeks ago, that co-authored a national popular vote bill, who took their name off of that bill and voted against that bill together because of the research that I did with that money.
When we come together, all of the interns, and discuss matters of importance, we discuss essays that we've read from a liberal and a conservative background and have to really grapple with those issues.
Through projects like our Young Leaders Program and our on-campus program, the Student Freedom Project, we are helping raise up tomorrow's leaders.
My name is Rebecca Phillips. I am the Student Freedom Project Coordinator at the Freedom Foundation. The Student Freedom Project exists to give students a place on campus where they can have conversations about free market ideas and learn about the solutions that exist in those ideas. Obama recognizes the possibility in my generation. He's actually made it a campaign strategy to go to college campuses and campaign directly to this generation. That's something that we need to be prepared for and respond to. Students get a lot of the same perspective on college campuses, and they deserve to be seen as more than just a campaign strategy.
Freedom Foundation has opened my eyes to the fact that, yeah, we can do something about it. We don't have to sit back and just watch as government increases and increases more in size.
Together, we can make sure that the torch of freedom is successfully handed off to the next generation. I think Rebecca's actually in here somewhere. Rebecca, are you here? She's out on the staff. Anyway, she's doing a fabulous job with that program. As we've done that, just to wrap up, it's been really interesting to see that we're suddenly getting calls and emails from professors that are excited to finally have somebody on their campus. I mean, we think, you know, that our students are only, there's sort of this sense that professors only think one way, and it's true a lot of the time, but we found them coming out of the woodwork saying, I agree with the free market, and I'd like to help you guys, and what can we do? Yeah, there's Rebecca. What can we do to do with you? And usually they're a little bit under the radar, you know, don't mention my name too much, but let me help you. But then there are others who are very much above the radar. And they have been in a very tough place. They've been willing to put their own careers on the line to speak truth into the hearts of students. We are privileged to have one of those people, a courageous freedom fighter, on our trustee board. And he's someone that has been a hero for me. He's here with us this evening, Dr. Matt Manweller. He's a professor at Central Washington University. He's an author, he's a writer, he's a speaker. He's a good friend of ours, and he's going to come speak to us. So please help me welcome Dr. Matt Manweller.
Well, good evening, everyone. Let me get my notes here. I don't have a video for you, so it's just me. But I do want to talk to you a little bit tonight about how I came to be here. I'm going to have a little fun with Irene. Irene got a hold of me a few months ago and said, Matt, you're not going to believe this, but we've got Stephen Moore coming to an event, and I would love it if you would do two things. I would love it if you would give a little talk about economics and then introduce Mr. Moore. And I was like, well, I'd love to. That's great. Stephen is somebody I've read many times, and you know, he's an intellectual hero of mine. I would love to sit next to Stephen, and I can tell you that picture is going to be on my Facebook page as soon as we walk out of here, right? And I was like, so we left at that. And after I got done talking with Irene, I was like, what the hell did I just agree to, right? I'm going to talk about economics right before Stephen Moore talks about economics. This is not a good idea. This is not a good idea for me. It's a good idea for Stephen. But it is not a good idea for me. My friends are accountants. Steve's friends are Arthur Laffer. Okay? So, in the true tradition, I wanted to let you know a little bit about my upcoming lineup that Irene has set up for me in the following weeks. Next month, I'll be here talking about the history of the universe before I introduce Stephen Hawking. And I'm going to give a little talk about constitutional law and originalism right before Antonin Scalia comes on. So stick around. And let me tell you, if anybody could get Scalia and Hawking to come to Bellevue, it would be Irene. So anyways, yes, absolutely. One other thing, I'm going to talk about a unique economic crisis. I mean, I know that a lot of people are aware of the many economic crises that we are facing, and I want to talk a little bit about an obscure one that I believe is under the radar and is not really receiving the media or intellectual attention that it should. I believe there are basically three economic crises facing the United States right now. One is that we have a budget crisis. The second is we have an entitlement crisis. And the third crisis, the one I'm going to talk about tonight, is what I call the moral hazard of taxation that is not getting any media attention. And I think that we need to start changing the direction because I think in many ways it's the most dangerous. So let's talk briefly about the two that we all know about. Everybody knows, if you read the Wall Street Journal, that we have a budget crisis. We are rapidly approaching $15, $16 trillion in debt. We actually, although we make fun of the Greeks, we have a higher per capita debt than the Greeks government, they are turning to socialism to solve that problem. Good luck. But I have two kids, and if the current debt rate increases, right now debt servicing costs are approaching 14% of our budget, but by the time my two kids, Lincoln and Grayson, are 18, they will each owe about $130,000, okay? That's $260,000 for my family alone by the time that they're 18, or 1 year at Whitman College, where I graduated. The second crisis in which we are facing is the entitlement crisis. Everybody knows that there is more money going out than there is coming in. Everybody knows that we have played fast and loose with some of that Social Security money, and there are many reports out there that put entitlement, our liabilities, at trillions more than our assets. And when you start using the T word instead of the B word, then that should get everybody's attention, especially if you're 61. Particularly maybe if you're 42, because then they will really be out of money. But here's what's interesting about both those crises. They're actually easy to solve, okay? I mean, when you have a budget deficit and you're spending more money than you are taking in, it doesn't take a rocket scientist or an economist to solve that problem. You either raise taxes, you spend less money, or you increase the size of the economy so that you get more tax revenue at the same rate. My little nod to Arthur Laffer there, Steve. Please note that I mentioned him, right? And that I would, any signed copy of a book that he wants to send me. but it's not a difficult concept. The entitlement crisis is of the same simplicity. Just because it's not easy to get voters to do, the entitlement crisis has a relatively simple solution. If you're giving out more in benefits than you're taking in revenue, you either bring in more in revenue or you give out less in benefits. But again, your average junior high math student could solve that problem. You don't need large, complicated statistical models to solve that problem. But the third crisis that I want to talk about tonight, what I call the moral hazard of taxation, is unique in that it is not only a problem, but it has no credible solution that I am aware of, at least no realistic solution. So here's the crisis, folks. As many of you may have already heard, there are about 47% of Americans who pay no federal income tax. Okay? At this point, having a society in which 47% of the people contribute nothing to our collective burden is simply immoral. But if we move from 47 to 51%, we are off a cliff which you may not be able to climb back from. And so because we are only 4% from a problem that has no solution, I think that this crisis is more dangerous than the other two that I've already mentioned. So why am I so concerned about the moral hazard of our tax crisis? Well, first of all, for all of you who are not the editorial director of the Wall Street Journal, let me take a moment to discuss what a moral hazard is. And what we economists call a moral hazard is when there is a separation of marginal costs and marginal benefits. And we speak like that so that we sound smarter than we actually are. But what we really are saying is a moral hazard occurs when you can garner more consumption without bearing any additional costs, a separation of risk and reward, a separation of marginal costs and marginal benefits. Now, the most common moral hazard that we're all aware of is a buffet. How many of you have eaten at a buffet? Okay. How many of you eat at a buffet differently than you are at a restaurant or, say, tonight? Right? A buffet is the classic moral hazard because once you walk into a buffet and you pay your initial cost, it doesn't matter if you go back for more food. You don't get an additional bill. So we've all been there at a buffet. We go, we get a steak, it's not that good. We take two bites. Take that away, I'm going back for something else, right? How many of you, honestly, there's no media in the room, how many of you have been to a buffet and you've tried like three or four different desserts? You took like one bite, you're like, I didn't really like that, and you go back for another one, right? Nobody does that at a restaurant because the more desserts you hire, the bigger your bill gets. But at a buffet, you have a moral hazard. There's a separation between additional benefits and additional costs. So you overconsume. It's all this, though, the explanation of why our healthcare problem is such a mess and will be not solved by Obamacare. Obamacare did nothing to solve the moral hazard of the copay. When you go to the doctor, I mean, here's a question I ask my students all the time. I ask them, do you know how much four new tires on your car costs? Every hand goes up, right? I say, how much an x-ray costs? They all just look at me. Well, why would I know what an x-ray costs? I'm like, well, have you gotten an x-ray? They're like, sure, but I don't pay for it. Right, it's a moral hazard. You go in, you make your copay, it's 10, 20 bucks. The doctor says, you need this. How many of you ever ask your doctor how much it costs? I'm like, who cares, right? You're not paying for it because you've already made your copay. It's a moral hazard. There's no additional costs associated with additional consumption, which is why our health care, we overspend and we have some problems. So the other example I sometimes give my students is imagine that you went to Vegas, right? How many of you have been to Vegas? Admit it. Okay, good, right. Imagine if you went to Vegas and they told you, here's the deal. You can gamble all weekend and whatever money you win, you get to keep. But if you lose, we're going to give you your money back. How many of you would bet differently? Right? Of course. I'm just like, I'd like to put $1,000 on green 00. If I win, I'm rich. And if I lose, well, I get my $1,000 back. That's a moral hazard, okay? Or sometimes I ask my kids, imagine if you got to go shopping with mom and dad's credit card rather than your own, right? Would you spend differently? They're like, yeah, I'd hang out in the flat screen TV section rather than the, you know, top ramen section, right? So these are all moral hazards. So let us consider the change. Right now we have 47% of the people paying no taxes. But let's step forward. Let's say that we make our tax system just that much more progressive, and we get to a point in American society in which 51% of us pay no income taxes. Well, 51% is the magic number, because we live in a democratic society. And in a democratic society, 51% of the people determine what we buy. Okay? We call them public goods. But imagine now that you have 51% of the people who say, I pay no taxes. So when a politician, someone running for office like myself, comes along and says, you know what, I got a plan. How would you like a new hospital? Usually taxpayers, when they see a politician offering them a benefit, have one question. What's it going to cost me? What are you going to do to my taxes? Are my property taxes going to go up, right? But with the moral hazard of taxation, if 51% of the people pay no taxes, 51% of the people can start voting for any public good that they wish. They say, oh, a new hospital, a new road, a new whatever, new health care, free college for my students, free health care, free daycare. An increase in marginal benefits will not result in any marginal cost. So, of course, I'm for everything, right? And that is a serious problem. Imagine if you have 51% of Americans saying, any proposal you have, whether it's efficient or not, mass transit, okay, I'm for it, because even if I garner the most smallest marginal benefit, because there are no marginal costs, I don't pay any federal income taxes, marginal benefits are always higher than marginal costs, and that causes individuals to consume. Okay, so that is the prospect that we are looking at. So think about the fact that under our current system, in which we do not have a moral hazard of taxation, we've racked up a $15 trillion debt. Imagine what it would be if 51% of the American people can go shopping with mom and dad's credit card. Whatever they buy, the bill goes somewhere else. Okay? It's one thing for an individual to have a moral hazard, right? They will run up a credit card bill that an individual will have to pay. But when 51% of us have a moral hazard, we get to run up a bill that, of course, the next generation will pay. And that, of course, that would be my two children. So that is a serious problem. But why is this problem different than the other two that I mentioned? Because of the absence of a readily available solution, right? Because imagine the scenario, folks, in a democratic society where 51% of Americans not only get to vote, but 51% of Americans pay no taxes. How do you solve that problem? The only way to solve that problem is to get the 51% of the people who pay no taxes to vote to increase their own taxes to the benefit of the 49% with whom that they can outvote. Now, in economics, we talk about the rational man, the rational actor. And under this model, no rational actor would cast that vote, right? None of us would probably either. You know, we like try maybe admit that we would, but the model suggests that we wouldn't, right? We would be asking a group of people to say, under the current system, you pay no taxes and you garner lots of benefits. And we would like you to vote for a new system in which you actually pay for what you consume. Why would a rational actor who can measure costs and benefits ever vote for that? So for the third crisis that I identify, it is kind of like one of those Chinese finger things that you used to get when you were a kid. Remember, they would come in the grab bag and you'd put your finger in them, but you could push your finger in farther, but you couldn't get your fingers out. The moral hazard of taxation is much like that. It is one of the few crises that once you get into it, there is no rational way in which to get out. Okay, and so that is why I am so concerned about this third crisis, and it's also a concern that we're so close to it. 47% is not that far from 51, and of course we're having these collective national conversations about increasing the taxes on one group and decreasing the taxes on another group, and I see what could be, you know, just an actually cascading economic and spending crisis. So, with that being said, what I'm going to do is what all smart people do when they identify a problem that has no apparent solution. You introduce somebody smarter. So in true academic form, I am going to explain a very difficult problem and then leave the stage. Oh, I'm sorry, we're out of time, right? And I will leave it to men and women smarter than I to solve that problem. And just such a person is with us tonight. Stephen Moore is the founder and former president of the Club for Growth. Most of you know what the Club for Growth is, but these are the guys that win elections for conservatives. And they raise money for political candidates who favor free market economics. He left that position in 2004 to take a different job, and he is now the Wall Street Journal's editorial board, on the editorial board, and their senior economics writer, and he's done this since 2005. And I read Mr. Moore's articles religiously, and I actually assign them in class and sometimes put them on my tests. He splits his time between Washington and New York, focusing on economic issues, including budget, taxes, and monetary policy. Over the years, Stephen has served as the senior economist for the Congressional Joint Economic Committee, as a budget expert for the Heritage Foundation, and the senior economics fellow for the Cato Institute, in which he has published dozens of studies on federal and tax and budget policy. And one of the things that I think is most impressive, he was a consultant to the National Economics Commission in 1987, and director for President Ronald Reagan's Commission on Privatization. Stephen is the author of several books, most recently, A Return to Prosperity, How America Can Regain Its Economic Superpower Status and End the Moral Hazard of Taxation. I might have added that last part to his title, right? Nobody thought that was funny but Stephen, so that's okay. So, Stephen holds a master's degree in economics from George Mason University, which is the heart and soul of the free market, Milton Friedman, F.A. Hayek School of Economics. So please help me welcome to the stage, Stephen Moore.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It is a great privilege to be with you all. Thank you so much. By the way, Mathew, I want to say a couple things about that excellent presentation. You are a tough act to follow. One of the rules of public speaking is you're not supposed to upstage the main act, and you've done that. But it was really fantastic presentation. You all know, by the way, you guys have to suffer a little bit tonight because you're going to have to listen to two economists back to back. And you all know the definition of an economist, right? An economist is someone who is good with numbers but didn't have the personality to be an accountant. And that is so true. But by the way, let me solve the problem right out of the bat. Okay, you are exactly right. That's the first time, by the way, at a dinner speech that I've heard a speaker use marginal cost, marginal benefit, all of these terms that they're fantastic. But the solution to this problem, which Mathew quite correctly identified, which I agree is one of the great problems with our country, and we are headed over a cliff if we allow this to happen. And here is my solution to this. I believe, and I wonder how many of you are with me on this, every American who is a citizen of this country, who has a job and has a vote, every single American should pay some income tax in this country. How many of you are with me on that? Everybody should pay some income tax. Even if it's $50 or $100, everyone should have some skin in the game for precisely the and by the way, Republicans are as responsible for this as Democrats are. I've worked for two or three Republican presidents. We keep taking people off the rolls as if this is a great thing. We just took another, Ronald Reagan, who I love, I think is one of the greatest Americans of the last century. He took about 10 million Americans off the tax rolls, and that is something that has to stop. I'm a big fan of a flat tax, and I talked to my friend Dick Armey. I think a flat tax, but not a $20,000 or $30,000 exemption, zero exemption. You pay that tax on the first dollar you earn, you could get the tax rate down to about 15%. So we've solved all the problems of the country tonight in a couple of minutes. How many of you are regular Viewers of Fox News, by the way. A lot of you are. What would we do without Fox News, right? I've got to tell you one kind of fun story. Last night I got in very late, flew in from the East Coast, got in about 1 o'clock in the morning East Coast time. So I was very tired. I was lugging my luggage through the Seattle-Tacoma airport, and this lovely little old lady, she just ran up to me, and she just threw her arms around me. It was so sweet. It was so nice, and she was so excited, and I was half asleep, but she really woke me up, and I said, and she said, "Oh, I know you, I know you," and I said, "I guess so." She said, "Haven't I seen you on TV?" And I said, "Well, I don't know, ma'am." I was kind of teasing her a little at this point. I said, "I don't know. What do you watch?" And that kind of threw her for a loop. And that kind of confused her a little bit. And she scratched her head. She looked back up at me. And she wouldn't let go of me. I'm suffocating. And she says, and this light bulb goes off. And she said, "Wait a minute." She said, "Didn't I see you on Wheel of Fortune last week?" And I said, "Yes, ma'am, that was me." It's great to be working with the Fox News. You know their motto, by the way, fair, balanced, and blonde, right? I've met a lot of beautiful women at Fox News, including Megyn Kelly, who I have to confess, my wife isn't here. I'm in love with Megyn Kelly. It's also been, you know, I just live a charming existence. I work for the greatest newspaper in the country, the Wall Street Journal, and I'm very, how many of you read the Journal editorial page pretty regularly? Thank you for doing that. I really believe it is the most important voice of the conservative movement, and when Rupert Murdoch took over the Journal, I know a lot of you had the same concern. We were very worried about whether Mr. Murdoch would, you know, inject his own ideas on the editorial page and change what has been such a bedrock of the conservative movement for so long. And I'll never forget this. In our first meeting, it was about 2 years ago, with Murdoch in the editorial board meeting room, we were very kind of nervous, and he gave this little presentation, and finally Paul Jugot, my boss, said, "Well, Rupert, we just really have one question for you this morning." We said, "What is your view of the Wall Street Journal editorial page?" And Rupert smiled, and he said, "What is my view of it?" He said, "The Wall Street Journal editorial page is my caffeine in the morning." And I thought, oh, we're safe. And I actually think, by the way, the newspaper is better than ever because of Rupert Murdoch's taking it over. I think it's a fantastic newspaper. Some of you may have heard me tell this, but it is important for you all to know that of the 5 major newspapers in the United States today, the Wall Street Journal, USA Today, Washington Post, LA Times, New York Times, only one of those 5 newspapers has an increase in its circulation. Anyone want to guess what newspaper that is? The Wall Street Journal. And by the way, I have even better news that I don't know how many of you have been looking at the circulation numbers and the finance numbers, probably not. But if you do and you look at the New York Times is about this close to being in federal bankruptcy court. And it couldn't happen to a nicer group of people, could it? So that is fantastic news as well. Irene, thank you so much for inviting me out here. I was really so thrilled when you asked me to come. I'm such a big fan of what Jonathan and Irene and all the staff of the Freedom Foundation have done such an incredible job in a really tough state. And one of the things I want to tell you is I talk a lot around the country to the state policy groups. I think they're just diamonds in the rough out there. And how many do we have now? Something like 75 or 80 of these. I think every state in the country now has a state policy think tank. And you know, we always talk about areas where we're winning and where we're losing. A lot of times we're losing in the media. But one of the areas that we have taken a giant leap forward ahead of the left is in the area of these state policy networks like the Freedom Foundation, where we have planted these seeds. And the kind of research that is being done and the scholarship is having a profound impact on legislation and on young people. And it's so heartening to see. So much so that George Soros, the mastermind and the wallet of the left, recently said, I watched him on this PBS show, and he was asked about state think tanks because, you know, George Soros is financing all of these left-wing movements. And George Soros said the one area where we are so far behind the right is in state policy groups. And he wants to create a network like we have on the right of excellent groups like the Freedom Foundation. And what he said was very interesting. He said, the interviewer asked him, "How much do you think it would cost to duplicate what the right has done with their infrastructure of these state policy networks?" He said it would cost him $1 billion. $1 billion to recreate what groups like Freedom Foundation have done. So you all have made an incredibly important investment. I know my good friend John Carlson is here. John, you started one of these state groups, and they're just, it's so great to see how they are so flourishing in this country. But you know what? They also are doing incredible work with incredibly tight budgets. And I'll say this, you know, one of my favorite state think tanks is the Texas Public Policy Foundation, which is in Austin, Texas. But that's not a hard job. It's not a hard job to run a conservative think tank in a state like Texas, right, where you've got a governor like Rick Perry who's just, you know, they put out the papers and he signs the legislation into law. The tough job is to run a state think tank in a state like this, in a town like this. I mean, I don't know how you do it. So I want to congratulate you for your great, great work. My wife, when I was running off to the airport last night, she says, "Where are you going?" Because she never knows where I'm off to. And I said, "I'm going to give a talk to a conservative group in Seattle." And she laughed. She said, "There are no conservatives in Seattle." And I just wish she could be here tonight, because it is so wonderful to see so many people care about your state and your country. And we're going to win this election, by the way. We are going to win this election in November. I feel more and more confident about all that with each passing day. So let me talk about a couple things that are first and foremost on my mind, just because they're issues that I've been working on that I feel are incredibly important and things that people have not been paying quite enough attention to. The first one, actually, people are paying a lot of attention to, and that is Obamacare. And I want to tell you that I was very privileged 2 or 3 weeks ago to actually have been able to sit in the gallery in the Supreme Court during the first day of oral arguments. That is an amazing, I mean, that was one of the thrills of my life. I mean, how many of you actually sat in on the in front of the Supreme Court? Now, some of you have. It's an amazing experience. It's a very small gallery, and the Supreme Court justices, for the most part, are very, very theatrical, so it's a really kind of neat thing to do. But this, ladies and gentlemen, this lawsuit against Obamacare and this Supreme Court decision, in my opinion, is going to be the single most important Supreme Court decision of the last 50 years. I really believe that. And I want to spend a minute talking about this because of the importance of it. First of all, we all know, I mean, I don't need to convince you that Obamacare is one of the worst pieces of legislation we've seen in the last, you know, 30 or 40 years. You all know that, so I'm not even going to go over the details of this. It is a dreadful, dreadful piece of legislation. But this Supreme Court challenge by the state attorney generals. By the way, John, is your attorney general here in Washington? Are you guys parties to this suit? Well, thank goodness. I mean, so great. You know, this is fantastic. We should have every single attorney general, because this goes well beyond whether we're going to have this stupid corrosive new health care law. Because what's really at stake here is the issue of the Commerce Clause. And look, I'm not a legal or constitutional scholar. Some of you in this audience probably know a lot more about the Constitution than I do. But I'm an economist, and the Commerce Clause really is one of the most important elements to the way our economy works. And what the Interstate Commerce Clause, and it was an ingenious feature put into the Constitution by our founding fathers, was the idea that the states cannot regulate interstate commerce. That if it's something that's influencing interstate commerce, that's the prerogative of the federal government to regulate that, not the states. And thank goodness, this is what has actually made the United States such a prosperous country. Because when you think about it, what is the United States? The 50 states, we are one gigantic free trade zone. Right, and that's what the Interstate Commerce Clause does. It says that the state of Washington can't put a tariff against products that are coming in, say, from Oregon. But what the left has tried to do is basically argue that just about every human action that we all take is a part of interstate commerce. And so they're saying, so here is the left's argument about Obamacare. What is being challenged is the idea that this individual mandate, the mandate that basically says you and you and you and you and you and everyone in this room must, by law, by federal law, purchase health insurance. And what the state Supreme Court, state attorney generals are saying is, wait a minute, how is it that this gentleman's decision here to purchase health insurance, how does that influence interstate commerce? That is to say, if you decide that you don't want to involve yourself in commerce, how in the world is that something that interferes with interstate commerce? And by the way, if the Supreme Court gets this wrong, And if they decide that your decision to buy health insurance or not to buy health insurance does interfere with interstate commerce, then think about the implications for that. What that would mean if we lose this case is what that would mean is that the federal government has the authority to regulate virtually every single activity that you take. Your decision to buy a Hershey bar or not to buy a Hershey bar, right, could be said to influence the price of Hershey bars and therefore influence interstate commerce. So what I'm saying is that the United States Constitution, the reason it is one of the greatest documents ever written in the English language, and it is, I believe, next to the Bible, this is the most sacred document ever written. The reason it is so important is and there's so many people in Washington Washington, D.C., who don't get this, is what the United States Constitution really is. It's a rule book, right? It is filled with safeguards to protect our rights and liberties as individuals. That's what makes it such a great document. It says the government can do some enumerated powers, it has some powers, but everything else, according to the Ninth and Tenth Amendments, those are rights that are reserved to the individuals and to the states. And this court decision is so important because it will be the first decision in many, many years to determine whether the Ninth and Tenth Amendment mean anything anymore. Are those rights still reserved for the individuals in the states? Now, here is the great news. I mean, I'm going to be very optimistic tonight because I'm an optimistic guy. I believe, if you had asked me a week or so before those oral arguments, what the chances were that the Supreme Court was going to invalidate Obamacare, I would have said maybe 1 in 3 chance. After all, it's very rare, it's very uncommon for the Supreme Court to invalidate a law that's passed through the democratic process, although I do believe that's the reason we have a Supreme Court. But after listening to those oral arguments, ladies and gentlemen, I believe we have an 80 to 90% chance that we are going to invalidate Obamacare. We are going to win on that one. And this will be a huge decision. And by the way, it's so interesting because, you know, when these state attorney generals first even said that they were going to challenge this, people like Nancy Pelosi and Barack Obama challenged this. On what grounds? How in the world could this be unconstitutional? I mean, they were totally contemptuous of the idea that this was unconstitutional because Nancy Pelosi and Barack Obama believe the federal government has unlimited powers, right? That's what they believe. That's what the left believes. They can do whatever they want if they can get a majority of the vote to do it. And that's why this is such an important decision, because they will be so, and by the way, my friends on the left, they agree with me because they paid very close attention to those oral arguments. And what was really so fun about this was, you all know this, right? Who's the most important person, the most powerful person in Washington, D.C.? It is not Barack Obama. It's not Ben Bernanke. Kirby, you know who the most important. Justice Kennedy. Justice Kennedy is the most powerful man, and he knows it, by the way. He knows he's the most powerful. We have 4 staunch conservatives on the court. We have 4 liberals, and in every single important decision over the last 20 years, Justice Kennedy has been the one to decide whether the decision swings to the right or the left. And what was so exciting about those oral arguments, folks, was guess who was asking the Solicitor General of the Obama administration the toughest questions? Justice Kennedy was. And it was just so fantastic to see. So I just wanted to let you know, we're going to win that decision. And I'm so excited about that. Now, the other thing I wanted to bring up is the other issue that I'm, by the way, can I get some water? I forgot to, that you haven't. So the other issue I wanted to bring up is one that I've been writing a lot about, and that is energy policy. And this is just such a cool story. I get into this stuff, so let me just, if I may, just spend a few minutes talking about this. What is going on in this country in energy policy today is so unbelievable. It is so spectacular. I just got back 3 weeks ago. I went to North Dakota. Nobody on the East Coast ever goes to North Dakota. I mean, how many of you in this room have ever been to North Dakota? Raise your hand. A lot of you have, but I guarantee you, when I ask people on the East Coast how many have been to North Dakota, isn't that somewhere on the West Coast? They don't even know where North Dakota is. What is going on in North Dakota? Let me just describe it like this. I went to Williston, North Dakota. It is like going to the Wild West during the Gold Rush days. What is going on there, as you all know, North Dakota sits atop of the Bakken Shale. And this is such an amazingly large amount of oil and natural gas that is in North Dakota. Let me just put a fine point on this. there is, because of the technological breakthroughs that have gone on just in the last 5 or 10 years with respect to drilling technologies, the United States of America, in the state of North Dakota, we have more oil in North Dakota than Saudi Arabia has oil. That's unbelievable, isn't it? We are an incredibly resource-rich. Now, look, some of the technologies we don't yet still have to draw out all of that energy, but we're getting there. And it is such a cool place to go, by the way. I had to pay $800 a night to stay at a hotel in Williston, North Dakota. There's nowhere to stay. These are towns that used to have 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 people. Now you've got 25,000 people in these towns, and it's growing every day. The trucks are just lined up. There's no infrastructure. God forbid, Kemper, that they build mass transit there. I mean, they need highways and they need pipelines. But, you know, it's so cool to see. And people, everybody, from whenever I see a panhandler in Washington, D.C. or New York, I say, what, you can't find a job? Go to North Dakota. I mean, the unemployment rate in North Dakota, the state with the lowest unemployment rate in the country is North Dakota. Officially, the unemployment rate is 3%, but when you're out there in these towns and you say you've got a 3% unemployment rate, they say, we don't have a 3% unemployment rate. We got a negative unemployment rate. They have 20,000 unfilled jobs in North Dakota. So I tell these panhandlers, just go to North Dakota, you can get a job. And it's happening all over the country. People are moving to North Dakota, so much so there was an article in the Wall Street Journal on the front page a few weeks ago, so it must be true, right? It's in the Wall Street Journal, that even the strippers in Las Vegas are moving to North Dakota because they can make more money in North Dakota than they can in Vegas. So it's a boomtown USA. It's so exciting to see. And here's the cool part about this story is so much of what is going on in not just North Dakota, but it's happening all over the country. It's happening, I'll talk in a minute about what's going on in states like West Virginia, Pennsylvania, New York, Ohio. This is all a result of this amazing invention called hydraulic fracturing. Now, this is, some of you may go, hydraulic fracturing, that's evil, right? Oh my God, that causes, you know, earthquakes and that's causing, you know, spillage in the groundwater and so on. Ladies and gentlemen, to be against hydraulic fracking like the left is like being against a cure for cancer. This is such an amazing technology, what they do. And I spent about 3 or 4 days out there, and the geologists spent a lot of time explaining this stuff to me. And it's not that complicated. They're able to now drill 2 miles deep into the ground. 2 miles deep, and then another technology that is fairly new is called horizontal drilling. And horizontal drilling means that they now can go 2 miles deep into the ground, and then they're able to go 2 or 3 or 4 miles horizontally in every direction. And that means it's the footprint on the earth is much smaller, because instead of having 100 oil rigs, they can have one rig that goes in all sorts of different directions. And it is so cool, because what they're doing is they're injecting water at very high speeds. What's happening here is that you've got these rock formations. The reason they call it a shale is that all this oil and gas are trapped in these, it's almost like an armor. It's 4 or 5 or 6 inches of this very thick rock formation that seems almost impenetrable. But they found a way through human ingenuity and human technology and human know-how to spray water, sand, and various chemicals into this rock formation, and they're able to penetrate with these little holes. And once they crack through these holes, that's where the oil and gas is trapped. It's like taking a cork off of a champagne bottle after you shake it up. The oil and gas just naturally seep up into the earth. And it's such a fantastic thing to see. They've got unbelievable amounts of oil that they're able to take out of the ground there. And it's the really neat thing about this is that if I'm right about this, and by the way, the same thing is happening in West Virginia and Pennsylvania, which is atop what's called the Marcellus Shale, we have 150 years worth of natural gas in those states. And, you know, I don't know how many of you have ever been to the town of Wheeling, West Virginia? You know then that Wheeling, West Virginia, if you were there 5 years ago, was one of the most depressed towns in America. And Wheeling, West Virginia used to be the epicenter of what we used to call the Rust Belt in America. I mean, shut down coal factories, shut down steel mills, every other store was closed. I was in Wheeling, West Virginia this summer. They're building BMW dealerships in Wheeling, West Virginia. People are getting so rich. The farmers are making millions and millions of dollars leasing their land because they sit above the Marcellus Shale. And they're, you know, these states are getting rich. West Virginia, Ohio, one of my favorite parts of the story. You know, somebody asked me during drinks, what are the 5 rich, you know, most liberal states in the country? And I wanted to say Washington State was one of the most, I think Washington State's maybe ranks 3rd or 4th most liberal. But the most liberal state in the country country, probably California and then New York. And these idiots in New York, has like this huge budget deficit. They can't, you know, do anything to pay their bills. They got all these people on welfare. They sit atop of the Marcellus Shale. And these geniuses in the New York state legislature outlawed hydraulic fracking. So they can't drill for the oil. So here's the cool part of the story. So Pennsylvania, what they're doing is drilling down, and then they're drilling underneath New York, and they're taking all their gas and oil out. It's just a great story, right? So it's just there's a rough justice in that, right? But the bottom line here is that I believe, and this is going to be kind of, this is a pretty controversial and shocking thing to say, but I believe it is true, John Carlson, and I've said it publicly, and there are a lot of people who are saying it now. Within 12 to 15 years, the United States is going to be an exporter of oil, not an importer of oil. Isn't that incredible? I mean, think about the implications of that for our country. Right now, we spend $350 billion a year importing this stuff, by the way, from countries that are not very favorable to the United States, right? Countries like Venezuela, countries like Iran and Iraq and Saudi Arabia. I mean, just think about the implications for jobs, for our GDP and our growth, and if we're able to export this stuff. So that's a cool story. The bad part of the story is guess who's against all this stuff? Barack Obama. Everything that his administration has done has tried to stop this from happening, right? He wants to stop hydraulic fracturing. He wants to stop oil and gas development. Why? Because the left believes that fossil fuels are evil, right? They believe these are evil fuels, and they're doing everything they can to stop this from happening. And so while this huge revolution is going on in oil and natural gas, what is the Obama administration doing? They're pumping billions and billions, tens of billions of dollars into wind and solar power, which are niche markets. There's no way that you can ever, you know, provide the kind of power you need in a $16 trillion industrial economy with wind and solar power, right? And by the way, I am so sick of these liberals in Washington saying, we need subsidies for the wind power, for the windmills, because this is an infant technology. Infant technology? We've had windmills for 2,000 years. How in the world is this an infant technology? But that's the way these people think. Here's just one statistic that I think will blow a lot of you away. I bet a lot of you probably know this because you're a very well-educated, you know, group of people, or else you wouldn't be part of the Freedom Foundation. What percentage of our electricity today, of our power today, do you think comes from wind and solar power? If you said it's not 4%. It's less than 4%. Today, we get about 2.5% of all our electricity and all of our transportation from wind and solar power. So these are niche markets. Even if Barack Obama, let's say that everything he's doing for all these companies like Cylinder and so on that are going bankrupt, let's say everything works out just wonderfully. And let's say, I don't think they could do it, but let's say over the next 20 years you could quadruple the amount of energy we were getting from solar and wind power. Okay, fine. Mr. President, where's the other 90% of our electricity going to come from, right? And this is just something that they're not thinking about. And what I'm saying is, this energy revolution will happen if only one thing happens. Get the federal government the hell out of the way. So that's the story with energy. Let me talk for a minute about what's going on with the budget. And Mathew, you did such a fantastic job of kind of setting this up, and I agreed with everything that you just said in terms of the crises that we face. Let me talk a little bit about what's going on with the federal budget, because I'm aghast. My real area of expertise is the federal budget and federal tax policy. I've been studying this stuff for 25 years. I never thought I would see the day that we have arrived at in this country. You know, there's a saying now, you talked about trillion versus a billion. The saying now in Washington is that a trillion is the new billion. You know, when I first came to Washington in the early 1980s, ladies and gentlemen, we did not talk about the budget in the trillions of dollars. We did not. We talked about the budget in the billions of dollars. Now they talk about it in the trillions of dollars, as if it's just a little leap forward. It's, you know, by the way, the first time I ever appeared on national TV, first time back in 1987 when I worked for President Reagan, I'll never forget, we introduced the first trillion-dollar budget. It's something we weren't very proud of as Reaganites. And I went on the Today Show with, what's her name, Katie Couric. I'll never forget this, so I was very scared and worried, you know, my first time on TV. And I studied the whole budget. I was ready for any question Katie Couric might ask. And sure enough, the first question she asked me is, she snarls at me. She says, Mr. Moore, I see that President Reagan has introduced the first trillion-dollar budget in American history. I have just one question for you this morning. How many zeros are there in a trillion? And I just melted down. It was the worst interview I ever did in my life. Do you know how many zeros there are in a trillion, by the way? 12. There are 12 zeros in a trillion. Now, think about that. Barack Obama comes in, he inherits a $500 billion deficit. And by the way, I do think that Barack Obama inherited a great economic crisis from President Bush, no question about that. I'm not going to be rah-rah Republican here tonight. But here's the point. If you listen to what candidate Obama said in 2008, remember this? He said he was going to cut the budget deficit in half. In his first 3 months in office, the federal budget deficit went from $500 billion to $1.3 trillion. In 3 months in office, of course, because he passed that dingbat economic stimulus plan that created virtually no jobs, right? This one of the great mythologies in Washington. Unfortunately, too many Republicans believe this, Kirby. We gotta cure Republicans of this. This Keynesian idea that government spending creates jobs. That is the kind of fundamental nature of Obamanomics. The more the government spends, the more jobs we have. Now, I've always said that the greatest economist of the last century, in my opinion, was the great Milton Friedman, who I was proud enough to call a friend. I just love Milton Friedman. And Milton was famous for a lot of things, but I think that one of his greatest insights, his greatest lines, Mathew, I think all economics boils down to this one statement. Remember this one? There's no such thing as a free lunch. There's no such thing as a free lunch. What did he mean by that? He meant that if the government spends a dollar, the dollar has to come from somewhere. Isn't that so obvious? I mean, you know, I don't think there are any little, maybe there's a little kid in the back of the room, so she should cover her ears. There's no tooth fairy out there, right? If the government spends a dollar, there's no tooth fairy passing out free dollars. The dollar either has to come from taxation, enormous debts, or printing money, right? And the point I would make is all of those extractions from the economy to get the dollar are more costly to the economy than the spending that the government does. By the way, I was giving a speech on a college campus the other day. Somebody gave me this. This is a Zimbabwean currency. Some of you may have seen this. This is $100 trillion. This must be worth a lot of money, right? I mean, look at this. This thing has like 14 zeros on it, $100 trillion. You know how much this thing is worth? Like 35 cents. I mean, there's a view in Washington that if only we could have everybody put an extra zero on every bill that they have, we'd all get rich, right? So John's 10 is worth 100 and your 20 is worth 200. I mean, that's Ben Bernanke economics, right? And Bernanke, by the way, was appointed by a Republican. What Ben Bernanke is doing right now is just deluging the economy with cheap money. That doesn't make the country rich, right? We need to have a productive economy. Now, let me talk a little bit about how big these numbers are. So in 4 years, well, let me be fair here. Let's count the last year of the Bush administration and the first 3 years of the Obama administration. So I'm going to be bipartisan here tonight. Over the last 4 years, 1 year of Bush, 3 years of Obama, the United States federal government has borrowed $5 trillion. $5 trillion. Ladies and gentlemen, that is more money the United States government borrowed, even adjusting for inflation, from 1776 through 2004. That's amazing, isn't it? I mean, to say we've borrowed more money in 4 years than in the first 200-some years of our country's history? We've borrowed more money in 4 years than we borrowed to finance the Revolutionary War, the Civil War, World War I, World War II, the Great Depression, and the Cold War? I mean, and what did we get for this money? Nothing. We have had 38 straight months of 8% plus unemployment. And most of you probably know this, the federal statistics on the unemployment rate are a lie, right? They're a lie because we're not counting the fact that under Barack Obama, 2 million people have dropped out of the labor force. They're not looking for jobs because there aren't any jobs. So if we counted those people as unemployed, the real unemployment rate in the United States would not be 8%, it would be closer to 10.5%. This is a dreadful economic record, and Barack Obama needs to be called out on this. He really does. I mean, Romney has to take that fight right to him. Now, I wrote a column that I'm really kind of proud of. It wasn't a genius column by any means. I called it Reaganomics versus Obamanomics. And boy, did this drive my liberal friends crazy. And all I did was said, look, we have two presidents, Ronald Reagan and Barack Obama, and they actually had something very much in common. They both took over office during the midst of terrible economic crises, right? Reagan took over from Jimmy Carter, right? By the way, I do believe this is one of the most important elections of our lifetime, but it is not important than the 1980 election. I believe the 1980 election was the most important election of our lifetime. And I always say the reason I know God smiles on this country is that Jimmy Carter was not reelected president in 1980. By the way, as terrible a president as Jimmy Carter was, isn't he even worse ex-president than he was a president? I mean, every time he opens his mouth, he says something stupid. In any case, So Reagan and Barack Obama clearly took over the presidency during a crisis. I mean, we had a mortgage meltdown. The big banks were failing. I mean, it was a terrible period. We were losing, he's right, we were losing 500,000 jobs a month. And so all I did in this piece was said, okay, these two presidents used totally different, diametrically opposite strategies to deal with the crisis, right? Ronald Reagan came in with an Art Laffer, Jack Kemp, Wall Street Journal editorial page, agenda of cutting tax rates to make the economy more efficient, deregulating the economy to get government off the backs of businesses, trying to get government spending down, getting inflation down. That was Reaganomics, right? Whereas Obama, of course, came in and just did the opposite. He, instead of cutting tax rates, he had this massive stimulus plan. We had bailouts, cash for clunkers, all these programs. And so what I said in this piece is, let's just compare what happened under Reagan, Model A, the free market Milton Friedman model, versus what has happened under Obama, the John Maynard Keynes model. And Mathew, I don't understand how our friends in the academia can still defend Keynesian economics. I mean, truly, we've had a massive experiment in Keynesian economics, and it did not work. And what do these Keynesians say? You know what? The problem with Barack Obama, he didn't spend enough money. That's what that is what they're saying, isn't it true? I mean, when you talk to your candidate, if he had only spent $2 trillion rather than $1 trillion, we would be in paradise right now. And these people are dangerous, by the way. This is really what they believe. Here's the amazing thing, though. Let's look at some of these statistics. Looking at the same juncture of Reagan's presidency versus where Obama is now. So let's go back to the first quarter of 1984, which is the equivalent of the first quarter of 2012. Anybody want to take a guess at what the economic growth rate was in the first quarter of 1984? 8.1%. 8.1. That's amazing. The fastest growth quarter we've had in 40 years. 8.1%. Obama's just came in last week. It was 2.2%. So the economy grew almost three times faster. Jobs. You know, we just came out with a jobs number, I think it was a week ago. We had 120,000 jobs under Obama. That's not miserable, but it's not much. We had 1 month in November of 1983, almost exactly the same juncture of Obama. 1 month under Reagan, 1.1 million jobs. In one month. Which system do you want, folks? I mean, this is not a complicated thing. And this is what Romney has to be talking about. This model of free enterprise works, and this model of expanding the government doesn't. Now, what's interesting to me is what is going on in Europe right now. And you mentioned this, Mathew, and I do think people always ask me, what is the importance of Europe these days? My own opinion is, look, Europe is a declining continent, right? I mean, these people just don't get it. They are addicted to the social welfare state. They're addicted to entitlement programs, and they're addicted to three-day work weeks and all of these things and being able to retire at the age of 55. I mean, nobody works anymore in Europe, right? I mean, this is the problem with Europe. They have more and more people on the government dole and fewer people working. And if you try to take those government benefits away from the Europeans, it's sort of in their DNA. It's what's so different about our character as Americans versus Europeans. Europeans have come to believe that these massive entitlement programs and these massive welfare benefits, cradle to grave, are a human right, right? They believe this is a human right. Hopefully, we haven't arrived at that moment in the United States. So when people ask me what is the relevance of what's happening in Europe, I always say the same thing. This is a signal from God, right? God is saying, don't go there, right? Don't do what Europe has done. And you saw what happened. I mean, the French elected an avowed socialist whose basic economic recovery plan is to raise the top income tax rate to 75%. Good luck with that, right? I mean, how many rich people will be left in France after they do that? And then what happened in Greece was even more frightening. You had the Socialist Party got 22% of the vote. The Communist Party got 14% of the vote. And the Neo-Nazi Party got another 10% of the vote. I mean, these countries are very confused, right? They don't know what to do, and they don't have that pillar of freedom, the kind of what I call the North Star of freedom and liberty that is driving them in the right direction. So this is why it's so critical that we not go over that cliff. That, by the way, it's not just Greece and France. Spain is in big trouble. Italy is in big trouble. These countries, one after another, they're dominoes. They are falling. We can't go that direction. And I really believe that. I believe Americans should be looking at Greece and France and just saying, God forbid that we should do that. And Obama is serving up the same kinds of programs. I mean, Obama actually believes, and this is something that I deal with these people every day on the left in Washington, D.C. They really believe that Europe is the example. They have what I call Euro envy. They want the United States to be more like Europe. And I say, God forbid that we should be more like Europe, because Europe is a basket case. Now, the last thing I wanted to say about this is I think, let me just speak for a minute, if I can, about tax policy, because this is going to be the single biggest issue in this election coming up. First of all, Barack Obama has made it very clear. He is going to run a campaign that is based on the theme of class warfare and class envy and pitting the 99% against the 1%. I'm sure, John, you talk about this all the time on your radio show, because this is every speech Barack Obama gives. He talks about this. The 1% versus the 99%. We've got to raise the taxes on these 1% because they've got all the money. It's these evil people like Bill Gates and Warren Buffett and Hannah Montana. They've got all the money, and we've got to take it away from them. And this is really the philosophy that Barack Obama is going to run on. Now, that philosophy, if you look throughout United States political history, for the most part, Americans have rejected that. I mean, we are an aspirational society. This is one of the great things about Americans. We don't hate rich people. We want to be rich, right? We don't hate Kemper. We want to be Kemper Freeman, right? I do. And you know, the fact is, these are the people who create the wealth and create the businesses and create the jobs in this country. If you look at the evil 1%, you know, those people in the top 1%, the people who make over $500,000 a year in America. What do you think those people do for a living? I mean, the IRS statistics are very clear on this. 3 out of 4 of those people in that evil top 1% category, they own, operate, or invest in small businesses in America. Now, every time I'm on TV with these people like Robert Reich, you know, he was the cabinet secretary. They pair me up with him all the time. Reich is always talking, we need more jobs in this country. We need more jobs. And I'm like, Bob, all you talk about is, you know, how we're going to get more jobs. And I always ask him this question. He has never once in 5 years that I've been debating him answered this question. Bob, how are you going to get more jobs if you're going to tax the businesses that create the jobs? There's no answer to that, right? I mean, there is no answer to that. You're not going to get more jobs if you suck more money out of the businesses that create the jobs. Now, if Obama is reelected, let me just give you one kind of, I don't want to scare you too much, but this is kind of a frightening implication of an Obama reelection. If Obama is reelected on January 1, 2013, the United States is going to face the biggest tax increase, what we call the tax-mageddon, in 40 or 50 years. And think about this. What happens if Obama's reelected? Well, first of all, the capital gains tax, which is now 15%, goes from 15 to 30%. That'll do wonders for the stock market, right? I mean, if we allow the stock market, the capital gains go from 15 to 30%, anybody want to own stocks with a capital gains rate going up? No, people are actually going to start selling their stock before that. The dividend tax, which is, I worked with President Bush when we got that dividend tax. Remember, this was part of the 2003 tax cut. We cut the dividend tax. I remember this very vividly. Went to see George W. Bush, and he wanted an economic stimulus plan, and we said, Mr. President, one of the best ways you could stimulate the economy is to eliminate the double tax of corporations. Because, you know, we tax corporate income at 35%, and then after those companies pay the corporate tax, when it's passed on to the shareholders in dividends, we tax the dividends twice, and that's double taxation. And President Bush got that. We said, let's eliminate the dividend tax in the United States and just tax it at the corporate level. And President Bush liked that idea a lot. That was his stimulus plan. We didn't get the rate down to zero, but we did get it down to 15%. And by the way, you had companies like Microsoft made the biggest dividend payments in the history of this country, of corporate America in this country, once the dividend tax was lower. So here's the thing. The dividend tax goes from 15% all the way to, it will be taxed as ordinary income under Obama, so it'll go from 15 to 40%, but then, one of the little insidious features of the Obamacare law that I bet a lot of you are not familiar with, there's a 3.8% investment tax surcharge in that bill. How many of you are aware of that, that there's this investment tax surcharge? So that's another 3.8%. So we're going to go from 15 to 42 plus 3.8, 45% dividend tax. We're going to triple the dividend tax on January 1, 2013. No, if anybody in this room who owns dividend-paying stocks, you probably want to sell them, right? Who wants to own a dividend-paying stock if half of the dividend is going to get taxed? And then, of course, the small business tax will go up from 35 to 42%. By the way, one of the things I like about Mitt Romney's plan is he wants to cut the tax rate. He doesn't want to raise it to 42. He wants to cut to 28%. That's a very sharp contrast, and I think it's something that that Mitt Romney should really be talking a lot about. So that tax increase is going to have a significant negative effect. Now, the left doesn't believe that. For those of you who read our editorial page, we couldn't resist. We put this piece on the page about a week or two ago by these two economists, one from the University of California, Berkeley, and another guy at MIT. And they argued, I'm not making this up, they argued on the page of the Wall Street Journal, these are two celebrated economists, one of them has a Nobel Prize in economics from MIT. They advocated raising the top income tax rate in America to 82%. This is what we're up against, 82% tax rate. These people are nuts, right? I mean, these are your colleagues in academia. I mean, who in the world believes that an 82% tax rate is going to work? And nobody's going to work under that. One of the columns I had that I was most proud of over the last year, I did this piece called Why Americans Hate Economics. And I just went through some of these dingbat things that left-wing economists are talking about. One of my favorite examples is all these left-wing economists for the last couple of years say, one of the ways we're going to stimulate the economy, right, Mathew, is they say we're going to increase unemployment insurance benefits. And this is going to cause more economic output and more people to work. Wait a minute, how? You're going to pay people more money not to work. You're going to give them 2 years of unemployment benefits, and all they have to do in exchange for getting these benefits is not working, and somehow this is going to lead to more work? I mean, any third grader understands that. And I used the example of my own house where I said, look, I have two teenage sons. You know, I have two teenage sons who I don't like very much, but I have an eight-year-old who I'm very fond of. But, you know, the two teenagers, you know, I said to them, get a job last summer. One of them did get a job. He did yard work. He worked 40 hours a week. And the other one sat on his butt all summer. And the Obama stimulus plan says we're going to tax the son that's working, right, so we can give that money to the one who's not working, and somehow that's going to increase work. And I said, I'll tell you one thing's for sure, in the Moore household, that's not going to work at all, right? It doesn't work, but that's the way these guys think. Those are the kinds of ideas that we are up against. That's why think tanks like the Cato Institute, Heritage Foundation, what John Carlson is talking about on the radio every day, and what groups like the Freedom Foundation are so important. They are on the front line of fighting against these dingbat ideas. And I'm going to end this on a really optimistic point, because I think this is really true. I believe this is the core of what I think about economics. I believe if we get a regime change in November of 2012, if we get this administration out, and you put, I don't know, that fruit basket there in the White House, anything other than the guy that we've got in there right now, you are going to see the biggest boom of this economy you ever saw. We have $2 trillion of capital in this country that is just sitting on the sideline. It is not being invested in the economy. Why? Who wants to invest in this tidal wave of new taxes? Who wants to invest with all these new regulations coming forward? Who wants to invest when you've got a president who hates business? You change those dials, and you change the dials from anti-growth to pro-growth, you're going to see the kind of boom we saw in the 80s and 90s in this country. You ain't seen nothing yet. But this is, so maybe I was wrong. Maybe this is the most important election of our lifetime. We have got to win, but we also have to have the intellectual superiority. We have to be right on the ideas, and we have to have idea factories like the Freedom Foundation leading the way. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. It's been a privilege to be with you. I'm happy to take some questions if you want. Thank you so much.
Wonderful. Wonderful, wonderful. Thank you, Steve. Steve has graciously offered to stay for questions, so where's my Juliana? She's got the microphone. There she is. Questions are welcome.
Steve, Obama likes to take credit for the automotive industry turnaround with the bailout and
GM, did you say the auto industry?
The auto industry, yeah. GM made a spectacular turnaround, it seems like. How do you address that?
You know, it's a tough one because, you know, the auto industry is doing extremely well right now. There's no question about it. In fact, in the latest GDP report, auto sales were a big part of the 2.2%. I think like almost half of the GDP growth, which was pretty meager, was a result of auto sales. But you know what? Guess which one of the big three auto companies is doing the best today? Ford. Guess which auto, by the way, if you want to be a patriotic America, I said this on Fox the other day, I got a lot of hell for it, buy a Ford car, not a GM or Chrysler car, because they did not take the bailout money. But I will say this, look, these bailouts never work. You do not create a thriving economy by taking money away from companies to do the right thing and give them, to, you know, look, we as believers in the free enterprise system believe that there should be a lifespan for businesses. And if businesses make the wrong decision, they should fail, right? I believe what should have happened with GM and Chrysler is they should have gone through a bankruptcy process. I mean, we have laws that determine what you do with companies that are losing money. Now, there's a very important reason why we didn't allow that to happen. Why do you think Barack Obama did not want GM and Chrysler to go through bankruptcy? Because of the unions, right. This was not a bank, this was not a bailout of GM and Chrysler. This was a bailout of the United Auto Workers, right? Those were the people who got bailed out. And you know what? The thing that was so, the people who got screwed, and I hate to use that word, but you know, they did get screwed. The people who got screwed were the bondholders, the people who owned the bonds of GM and Chrysler. We have 500 years of legal precedent, which basically says that when a company loses money and it's going through bankruptcy, the first people in line are the creditors, right? Except we overturned 500 years of common law. Obama just said to the creditors, you're not going to get your money, because he essentially stole $50 billion from creditors. And by the creditors were everybody, people with pension funds and so on, and he gave that money to the unions. And by the way, the unions have made very few concessions. Here's the problem I have with this. We have now established a principle that every time, look, the next time we have a recession, the auto company is going to go through tough times again, and guess what? The United States government is going to be there to bail them out again and again and again. And that, I think we made a big mistake. I don't know how you all feel about this. I think bailing out the banks was a big mistake. I just don't think that you should take money from companies that made the right decisions and give the money to the companies that made the wrong ones. So I don't think that the auto, by the way, the United States taxpayer has still not been paid back all of the money that we lent and gave to GM and Chrysler, and I don't believe that we ever will get that money back. So it was very expensive to taxpayers, and I think it has created, you used the term moral hazard. We created a huge moral hazard problem with the auto bailouts. What we have created in the United States is a very unhealthy situation where every Fortune 500 company now believes they're too big to fail, right? And that leads to all sorts of problematic decision making. On the housing, I want to just touch on that if I can. I think what has been most inept is the way that we've dealt with this housing crisis. We continue to pay people to, you know, we've had $400 billion of what we call mortgage modification programs. We keep paying people, you know, to pay their mortgages. I have a bumper sticker on my car that says, honk if I paid your mortgage, and everywhere I go, people are honking at me, you know. Everybody's paying for everybody else's mortgage. And think about this. Look, I think everybody in this room, and look, 90% of Americans did the right thing. They are paying their mortgage on time. Right? It's a financial sacrifice for a middle-class family to make those mortgage payments. And what we're doing in America is we're saying to those people who did the right thing and are making the sacrifice to make their mortgage, and they acted responsibly, right? And by the way, this idea that people took out these bad mortgages are victims of evil bankers is ridiculous. 30% of these people lied on their mortgage application forms. But now we've got a situation, and this is what's very unfair. People who paid their mortgage on time and acted correctly and acted responsibly now have to pay extra taxes for people who didn't act responsibly. And that is a moral hazard problem. And we keep creating these. And by the way, on that subject, if you look at, I think somebody mentioned, I think it might have been you, Mathew, mentioned this Dodd-Frank bill to deal with financial crisis. I just got to tell you this, folks. This is so, so frustrating and so unnerving. I've read that 800-page Dodd-Frank bill. Anybody want to take a guess at how many pages of that bill deal with Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac? Zero. Not a single page of that bill deals with the institutions that were at the epicenter of the crisis. So I don't think we've done anything to protect ourselves from future financial crises by the actions that we took in the last. And by the way, you know, I'm going to be bipartisan here. Those were mistakes that were made by the Bush administration as much as the Obama administration.
Next question.
I've got a question for you. This is going to put a little pressure on you to be a predictor. You were talking about the healthcare lawsuit. I've heard discussions that say if we win 8-1, or, you know, 7-2, this will be the stake in the heart of nationalized health care forever. Will we get that kind of victory, do you think?
Look, I don't know. I'm not going to get greedy here. I'll take 5-4. You know, I just want to win this one because here's the thing. If we win this decision, and I don't think there were, I think, three issues that the court dealt with. The first one was the most important one that I discussed. The other two have to do with severability, and there was another issue with respect to expansion of Medicaid. I don't think we're going to win those two. I think we are going to win the issue of ruling out the individual mandate. But and that means that the rest of the law would stand. But guess what? Obamacare doesn't work if you get rid of the individual mandate. That's what every economist has said. That's why they put the individual mandate in the law. Because if you have Obamacare with this very low-priced health care that's subsidized by the government, and then you have a system where you can just opt out, you don't have to buy health insurance, we know what's going to happen. Every healthy person in America is not going to buy health insurance, and every sick person is going to buy health insurance, and that sends the system into a death spiral, and the whole system is going to come unraveled very quickly. The good news is, look, I actually think, you know, when I talked about the energy revolution, I think we're really at the tip of a healthcare revolution in this country, and it is consumer-driven healthcare. That is the future. It's exactly the opposite of what the central planners and what the way Obamacare works is, and this is so Soviet. It's a Soviet-style system. They're going to get all these smart people in Washington, and they're going to determine what everything should cost, right, John? I mean, this is their model. This is what an MRI, you know, this is what an X-ray should cost. This is what hip surgery should cost. They're going to set prices. They're going to try to, you know, sweat out the cost by having these smart people in Washington. You don't need that. Just let the market system work. Let individuals all over the country make their own decisions about their health care. I was in Phoenix a couple weeks ago. I visited this company, Cancer Center Treatments of America. I don't know if you have that here in Washington. It's an amazing place to be. It's the future of medicine. I spent the whole day there, and it's incredible. It's like checking into a spa. And they are so consumer patient driven, and this is what healthcare should be. And you know, I talk to the patients; they love it there. They don't feel like they're just being put on a conveyor belt. They feel like the people care about them. They explain what their conditions are. They're taking people who the normal system, normal hospital system, have failed and advanced stage cancer, and they have an incredible success rate. Well, we in the United States just let all sorts of innovation flourish. Let consumers purchase whether it's alternative healthcare or traditional healthcare. Or consumer cancer treatment in America, everybody should be able to decide for themselves. And what is the most evil, John, in my opinion, about Obamacare is not how much it costs, it's going to imperil the future of our health. I mean, we're talking about our medical care in this country, which is so sacred. So I believe we are very close to having a renaissance in healthcare that's going to be unbelievably productive. You're going to see, I really believe this, we're going to see in the next 20 years cures for cancer, multiple sclerosis, we're going to see cures for Alzheimer's. I mean, there's so much going on in the frontiers of medicine. It's all being held back by government. And so that's another reason why this Obamacare law is so important, because the Obamacare law regulates this in the same way they want to regulate things like hydraulic fracking. Anything else? Yes, sir. Oh, I'm sorry.
Steve.
Barb, how are you?
Okay. I loved your enthusiasm about fracking.
That's fracking. It's huge.
But
it's huge.
Is the EPA going to put a wet blanket on it?
You know, they're going to put regulations on it. They're going to try to regulate out of existence, Barb. And they're already doing this. Then, you know, let me just give you one example. There's a movie, the left has their fangs out for trying to stop hydraulic fracking. The Sierra Club, this is an amazing story. Just last week, the Sierra Club issued a new nationwide campaign called Beyond Natural Gas. Beyond Natural Gas. It's one of the most imbecilic, dangerous campaigns I've ever heard of in the history of the environmental movement. And these people are pretty wacko. And what they're basically saying is they don't want another natural gas electricity plant built in this country. Now, here's the thing that's amazing about that. In the last 5 years, guess what industrial country, of all the industrialized country, guess which country has reduced its carbon emissions the most? The United States of America. Now that's amazing, right? Because we don't have a cap and trade system like Europe does and Japan does. We're not signatories to that idiotic Kyoto Treaty, right? So you would think we'd have our emissions going through the roof, and they'd be cutting their emissions, right? And it's just the opposite. We've been cutting our emissions. Their emissions continue to rise because they've violated every treaty that they've signed. Now, The question is, why have carbon emissions been reduced in the United States? There's two reasons. One is we've had a terrible recession, right? And when you reduce your output, you emit less carbon. But the second reason is more important. What's happening in America is we're converting away from coal for electricity towards natural gas. Natural gas is a clean burning fuel. It emits very few pollutants into the air. That's why they call it natural gas and a clean burning fuel. Now look, if the environmentalists really believed that global warming is gonna cause cataclysmic repercussions and that we're all gonna burn to death and the planet is gonna die in 50 years, they would be doing cartwheels down Pennsylvania Avenue for natural gas. Right? Because the more quickly we can convert from coal to natural gas, the more dramatically we'll reduce our carbon emissions. But now they're leading a campaign against natural gas. And the reason for that is they hate anything that works, right? They don't care about global warming. They just want to stop anything that works. When natural gas was $15, they were all in favor of it. Now that it's $2 and it's so cheap and abundant, they want to stop it. And I just think that's incredibly hypocritical. So that's where we stand with energy right now. I'll take one more question, then we'll wrap this up.
Just yes. Kind of interested in your comments about how you see the Senate race. The Senate, whether we will take the Senate.
Here?
No, I'm not.
Nationally, okay.
Washington is cause. Let's just look at the national Senate.
So can I just say something about the presidential race before I do? Because obviously that's the big one. First of all, in my lifetime, I've been around politicians for 30 years. I ran the Club for Growth, so I know these guys very well. I've always said that in my lifetime, there have been three politicians who have been head and shoulders above the rest in terms of their ability to communicate a message to the American people and to connect with the American people and to light up a room when they walk in. Ronald Reagan, Bill Clinton, Barack Obama. There's just something about those three. I mean, I knew Reagan very well. I mean, he just lit up a room every time he came in. Bill Clinton, God, he was like your fraternity brother. I mean, the guy is an incredible, communicator. And Barack Obama has that skill, too. It's dangerous, right? But he's very charismatic. He's a very good communicator. He connects with the American people. The American people like Barack Obama. I mean, they very much wanted this president to succeed. So it's going to be a high hurdle to get people to admit that they made a mistake in voting for him. But the reason I mention that is actually there is a new politician on the frontier who has that X factor that Reagan, Clinton, and Obama have. Anybody who knows who I'm talking about? Not Marco Rubio. Rubio's good, but he's not as good. Chris Christie is who I was talking about. Chris Christie is an unbelievable politician, and he is an incredible communicator. And you just watch on YouTube, his speeches and so forth. He's incredibly talented. I think, first of all, I just think he should have been the Republican. It's a tragedy he's not at the top of the ticket, because I don't think Mitt Romney is an especially good candidate. I like Mitt Romney, too. I like him very much personally. I just don't think he has that X factor. And by the way, I told Chris, because I know Chris very well, I said, Chris, you're making a big mistake not running, when he finally made his final decision not to run. And he said, Steve, I just really felt like the time wasn't right for me to run. And, I just felt like I had family things and the timing wasn't right. I said, Chris, your timing wasn't right. A new poll just came out. 40% of Americans are obese. You got 40% of the electorate wrapped up, right? He didn't like that very much, but it's true. But look, so now you've got Mitt Romney, and this is going to be a problem because Mitt Romney is charismatically challenged. When you've got a Republican candidate who's asked about NASCAR and he says, I don't know any of the drivers, but I know all the owners. I mean, he just doesn't have the common man's touch. This is going to be a problem because there's going to be a mismatch in terms of the ability to speak and communicate. That's why Mitt Romney has to stick to principle, and he has to basically keep this very simple. It's about Obama's failed record, and it's about getting back to free market policies that work. So, look, I think that I think in the end of the day, people are going to go in that voting booth on November 4th, and they're going to ask one question: can we afford four more years of these policies? And the answer is so obviously no that I think Obama's going to lose. Now, on the Senate races, if I am right about Obama losing, and I think you're going to see about a 3 or 4 percentage point victory for Romney. If that's the case, yeah, you're going to have a Republican Senate too. You're going to probably have 4 or 5 pickups in the Senate, and that means you're going to have Republicans running the table. And right, you were telling me, Kirby, you're going to win the House and Senate in Washington State.
So, you know, that's fantastic news. So you're going to, here's the danger on this. And Kirby, you know, you've been a friend of mine for a long, long time. Even though you head the Republican Party, I still like you. But look, here's the day. And I know you know this because you're a conservative first and Republican second. If Republicans strike out this time, the voters will never forgive them again, right? I mean, we were all pissed off at the Republicans, and right? The reason we voted them out in 2006 is they lost their principles, right? They started spending like Democrats. In 2010, the voter said, okay, we're going to give Republicans one more chance, and we had a big overwhelming victory for Republicans. If they run the table again in 2012 and they start passing things like Medicare prescription drug bills and that education bill that George Bush passed and, you know, all these things, you're going to see a third party in this country because people will give up on the Republicans. I don't think that's going to happen. I think Republicans do understand they've got to lead through a free market, limited government agenda, and if I'm right about that, folks, this is a great, great time to be American because we're going to see an American renaissance and a conservative renaissance in this country. Thank you very much for having me tonight. Thank you.